Dave Johnstone from Ammonia. Hello, or these days it's Dave from Ammonia. How are you?
Great, Jane. How are you, mate? It's been 20-odd years.
It's so good to see you. Look, the news that you are joining our Sound As Ever Presents Leaps and Bounds show has prompted me not only to reconnect with you after such a long time, but also to find out what you've been doing in such a long interim, in such a big break. I think we last saw each other around 99, maybe. Yeah.
Maybe it can be 98. I think when Ammonia split up, so it'd probably be around that time. I kind of want to go, would have disappeared off into the ether, into corporate Australia. What have I been doing for the past 20 years?
Yeah, that was my next question. Thanks for prompting me. Dave, I got to ask, what happened to Ammonia? What happened? I know it was around the 11th Avenue album. I know that the cracks started appearing there around 98. What do you think it was? Was it pressure from record companies? Was it the intense pressure from being in a band with two other guys? Was there creative differences? What do you put it down to?
I think it's the same with every band who's been on tour. We lived in each other's pockets for six solid years, and we just, everywhere we went, 24 hours a day, we were just in each other's pockets. And we're no different from any other band that split up. We just burnt out, basically. There was nothing left in the tank for anybody. I remember it was on our last tour, and everyone had just had it. We were tired, and we just come off that. I mean, the last tour was great. We like sold out every city. We were doing really well, but we just had enough. We just burnt. Like, we literally just did it for 6 years, and we're just exhausted. And I think I was 28, and I was sort of going, look, if I want to start, you know, having a family or doing that sort of stuff, music ain't going to be the most stable place for me to be a dad or something like that. And I think the other guys wanted to move on as well. So, but we had a crack. We went all artsy on the second album, tried to give it a real crack in the States, and just didn't work out. But, you know, that's the story of every other Australian band. Well, not every other Australian, but you know what I mean. It's the story of every band. It's just the machinations of being in a band. It's no different from anyone else. So, yeah.
So how did you navigate your path post-Ammonia?
With a great deal of anxiety. I think when you've just been doing that your whole life and you are a musician, that's it. That's all I did for most of my 20s. It was just like, oh, my God. There was literally a moment, I was like, what the hell am I going to do now? And at the time, it was actually quite, I said, what am I interested in? I said, oh, I'm interested in computers. You know, how do I get into that? You do it this way. And so I just went off and literally started studying again.
So you actually did a course in order to get a job because you felt you didn't have the appropriate skills?
Yeah. I mean, I had a degree, but it was an arts degree. I didn't actually have a computer science degree or anything like that. And back in the day, you could just do Microsoft courses and you did them. And then you just got in the industry. And I've been there for, what is it, 23 years?
My goodness.
Yeah, so I kept my head above water. But I remember, I don't know how, but I remember I was living in, where was it, in Clifton Hill, and I was playing with a bunch of guys, and I just started work in the office, and it was just a complete mind meld. I was literally coming from touring in a band, and then all of a sudden you're in a suit working in an office, and my brain was just not dealing with it at all. And I remember actually rehearsing in the living room with a new band, some friends I was playing with, going, oh, my God, I know how to do this. this is easy. This is great. How the hell do I do it? And so I reckon about the first 6 months or so I was just anxious and trying to keep my head above water, but I did. And so it's been a great career.
So have you always dabbled with music in the time? I mean, you've held down this full-time job.
Yeah.
You know, you've been working in computers. Have you been dabbling in music?
I never stopped playing, ever. Every day I play.
Wow.
But I was playing – I've played in a bunch of bands, but nothing that's nothing with management, nothing that – it was more like just a bunch of friends and I get a couple of gigs here and there, and it was fun. Now, there was a band called Parlor, which was – Phil Nett and who else was in it? Sean Lahore, The Favourite Game from Perth. So that rhythm section, I played with them for a while. And then I literally played with The Favourite Game in a band called The Peaks, and we released an album called Evoker, which is floating around somewhere, which is a great album.
Yeah.
But same sort of thing. It wasn't like we were going to go on tour or anything because everyone was trying to hold down jobs and starting families and all that sort of stuff. Then I was in another band called The Lazy Birds, who I love. I still love The Lazy Birds because that's there's a band from Perth called The Mars Bastards. And they were just like Ian Freeman and Jeff DeBrains are just these songwriting geniuses. They're legends. In Perth, they're kind of legends anyway. And so it was literally the rhythm section from The Favourite Game, myself and Ian and Jeff, this five-piece. And we released another album, which I don't think it's on Spotify. Yeah, I think Scott's heard it, but it is a cracker. But it's all sort of power pop. It's all jangle. It's not heavy at all. And it's nice that I can actually play that sort of stuff because that's the stuff I love. I also love really heavy stuff as well, don't get me wrong. But it's nice to know that, to show people, it's like, I don't just do the heavy stuff. I actually genuinely love a Rickenbacker through, you know, a box. It sounds wonderful. And playing with those guys, because they're such good songwriters and because Ian's such a good vocalist, it's an absolute pleasure. And it was one of the best bands I'd ever played in.
Wow.
I used to just get goosebumps when we used to play. I just love it. And then it kind of went a bit quiet. Then the kids, I think every parent goes through this, but the dad band at school sort of dragged me out of retirement. And honestly, this is sort of a continue. It never stopped. This was like five years ago, and it sort of kept going. So one of the guys I met through that is still playing bass with me now. That's Mark. It never stopped. Just quietly bubbling along under the surface.
You've just been doing your own thing. Yeah, quietly bubbling away, as you said, out of the spotlight, happily.
Yep.
And that's the way it's been now. You haven't wanted to revisit Ammonia, you said to me earlier.
No.
Until now. So what's changed? What happened?
I think Scott kind of prompted me a little bit. And he was asking me these questions, excuse me, about Ammonia and all these sort of, and asking about really old stuff, like one of the first things we ever did. I sort of started digging back through all my old stuff and like going through it and checking, going, wow. And my sister, luckily, she saved almost every single press clipping.
My goodness.
That we ever had. And I've still got them all. And so I'm flicking through and it's going, oh my God, we had this wonderful trajectory. We're going like up, 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 up. And it's like, bang, we hit. And then it was just like this mild sort of decline as we were going along.
Is that how you see it, as a decline? Yeah.
Well, internally, yeah.
Right.
Personally, yeah, 100%. Creatively, not really. I thought we were actually doing because Min 400 was just like that's what we had. We threw it out there.
That exploded.
And it was so fast. And then, but it wasn't really us because all our influences are completely different. And then on the second album, on 11th Avenue, I thought, okay, let's start exploring what we actually really do sound like. And I think that's quite common with a lot of bands. So they have all this enthusiasm and they're just throwing out all that kind of that attitude. But once, you know, after like the second or third album, all the real influence starts to come out. And I think that's when the second album happened, and it was, people weren't expecting it because all they knew about us was drugs. Really. And there was obviously a bit of a backlash because it's that sort of song which would get annoying. And I completely get it.
It is still that same sort of song. It still gets played, Dave.
Yeah, I know. And it's super catchy. And everywhere I go, down my kids' footy, people are always singing it to me as they're walking past. I'm like, oh my God, I can't get away from it. And I don't mind. Like I actually am quite thankful for the song, to be quite honest with you. I mean, it got us all around the world.
Yeah, and it would have earned a bit of coin too for you over the last 20 years or so.
Oh, yeah, not really.
Give or take.
I think I get like a $50 check every 6 months or something.
It's better than nothing, eh?
Better than nothing. Yeah.
And so you revisited all these old songs, looked at all these old clips, and then you felt that enough time had passed that.
Yeah. And I kind of thought, I'd like to do this. And the guys I was playing in another band, Quick Quick Slow. We just released an album like a couple of years ago, and that was with Mark, and that sort of fell apart, as they all do. And we got a new drummer, Bren, to come and play with us, and it was just a three-piece. And I was just thinking, oh, three-piece. I like three pieces.
They're a famous Fove song. Everyone's getting a three-piece together.
Yeah, and they were 100% right. Those guys used to come. They used to borrow my amp every time they'd do an album. They come around knocking on my door. Dave, can we borrow your amp? Like, yeah, come around. And Coxie and they'd come around. My wife is a big Fove's fan, so Coxie, here you go. And so they come around to my little flat. And they go, here you go. Here's my amplifier. And my wife in the background. Go, so excited. The Fove's would come around. I'd see them every time they were doing an album, they'd be coming around, popping around, borrowing my amp. So next time they do it, I'm going to tell them, look, you can have it, but I have to play on your record. Anyway.
That's a fair call.
I started looking into it and I thought, you know what, I actually wouldn't mind doing it again. And then it's sort of, the gears start turning and I thought, who would I like to be involved? And my old managers, Kathy and Kate, who are dear friends still, after all this time, I thought, I wonder if they're interested, you know, would they be keen on doing it? And I called them and they said, yep, 100%. And I was like, really? And they're going, yeah. So I was like, all right, okay. And so I threw it to the other guys who I was playing with, and they were like, totally, yeah, let's do it. So it's been nothing but positive vibes, and Scott sort of prompting in the background, you know, it's been I didn't need much prompting, to be quite honest. You know, just needed someone to go, would you do it? I said, yeah, probably would.
Wow. So, yeah. Well, we're certainly grateful. I'm definitely looking forward to the show. Will it be you revisiting the Ammonia catalogue, some of your favourite highlights from those albums and from those EPs?
Yep.
Will you go as far back as, say, In the Box EP?
Yep, 100%. So there's a whole bunch of In a Box, Sleepwalking. I'm going to give away the whole set if I can even remember the whole set. there's a whole bunch of stuff off 11th Avenue, which I think deserves more attention because they're good songs. They're genuinely good songs. And there's one song that I wrote immediately after Ammonia split up, and it's called Feel Better, funnily enough, because I think everybody felt better that the band split up, which is kind of it was really cathartic. It's not as horrible as it sounds. I think it was about everybody feeling a lot better. It was like this massive weight had lifted off everybody's shoulders. And a couple of brand new ones that we did with Quick Quick Slow that I'm really proud of. It's a real mix, and it's kind of a little moodier than what probably Ammonia was. It's good. I'm very happy with it. So they're very good musicians. It's great.
We're going to revisit one of your Ammonia pasts. One of the highlight tracks, I reckon, from 11th Avenue that did very well for you. Mm-hmm. You're not the only one.
You're not the only one who feels this way. You're not the
when you see that, Dave?
Why was I wearing that jumper? Oh, and I miss that Rickenbacker.
Yeah.
Ian's got it. Ian Freeman's got it. So I haven't seen it in, I don't know, 15 years or something like that. So I'll be...
It's interesting you mentioned the jumper, because when I think back to Ammonia, I remember the glasses, which weren't yours, obviously, the glasses and the jumper.
Yep. Someone said, like, quintessential 90s. Like, really? Nothing changed. My fashion sense is still the same.
She's got little tiny less hair.
Yep. It's kind of going back a bit. That's about it.
Is there, do you speak to the other guys, the ex-Ammonia lads?
No.
Was that amicable? Has it ever, have you spoken to them over the odd 20 odd years?
No.
I do remember John O'Donnell once saying to me, Jane, they hate each other.
Yeah.
Would you go as far as that?
Well, honestly, I'm not, when we split up, we played our last gig at the Perth Big Day Out. And I remember it really vividly. And after that, we basically haven't had contact. Wow. But you got to remember that it was a really tough mix of personalities. And I'm probably just as much to blame as all the other guys as well. But it was just hard, you know. I was like, just living in each other's pockets for that period of time. It's like we just needed a break.
Mm,
mm. I live in Melbourne. They live in Perth. So, you know. So,
all right. Well, I hope perhaps you getting on back on the gig bandwagon as Dave from Ammonia maybe prompts them to hold out olive branches, or maybe not.
We'll see. Who knows?
That aside, what are you most proud of from that time? And I know, music aside, because I know you mentioned the 11th Avenue record you're really proud of, but it was an incredible trajectory for a band out of Perth. You were the second signing to Murmur after Silverchair.
Yep.
And you were determined to be signed by a label that wasn't, you know, your stock standard indie label.
Yeah, we kind of had a little bit of a brush with a label and it just didn't go well. And we just kind of thought, you know, yeah. When they came over, it was a brand new label. I really liked the Johns, like John O'Donnell and John Watson. They were lovely. And they just seemed like, you know, I just got a really good vibe from them. And plus they just wanted to sign us, which was nice. They were new. We were kind of keen to get signed because we were, you know, really keen as mustard to get out there and do stuff. We really wanted to make it a career. And so they knew we were hungry. And so, yeah, and they could hear, I mean, even back then, I think we had Drugs as like a 2-minute song. It was almost like a joke kind of thing when we first wrote it. And I think they could hear that.
Right.
And they thought, oh, there's something, there's a hit there. And so then we went to the studio and it sort of fleshed it out a bit as well. I forgot what the question was.
What stands in your mind as one of the pivotal moments in being in Ammonia? What are you most proud of?
Honestly, probably getting to the States was really big.
Tell me about that.
We went over there and we toured a lot. Like I remember we went over there and we were sort of, we're okay, we're a good band. You know, we always thought we're a good band. We kind of got over there and kind of went, we're not good enough. And in that process of touring, I think we were there for 3 months or something like that, literally the band got pulled apart and put back together and we were really good by the time we got back. And because you were playing every night, you're just getting better and better and better and you can figure out what is the crowd like, what don't they like, what am I doing right, what am I doing? And you become, you know, a proper touring musician.
Who are you touring with? Were you paired with a band of...
Oh, yeah, it was a bad mix. Not a bad mix, it was probably a miss. We were supposed to go with Local H.
Right.
Which would have been great.
Yeah.
We ended up going out with Skunk and Nancy, which was just an odd mix. That was great. Really good band, but it probably wasn't the right band to go out with. And we played with Silverchair at a couple of festivals as well. And they were huge. They were like, we played in Atlanta to 5,000. And we played at Chicago to like 15. And we're just like, oh my God, this is our first time in the States, and we're just playing to these enormous crowds, all on the back of Silverchair, of course, because you know, they were enormous at the time. And then we went out on tour by ourselves. So I'm really proud of that. I think the other guys probably would back me up as well. I'm really, really proud of it. But the second album, the first album I'm really proud of because it was done in 10 days. And we had a great producer called Kevin Shirley.
Yeah. He's got a great pedigree behind him.
And, you know, you don't realise it at the time, but you knew, I mean, we all knew how good he was because he was super talented, obviously. And he was just arranging the songs, going, do this, do that, do this, do that. I'm going, wow. And 10 days later, you've just got an album. The second album, we wanted to explore some stuff, which is why we got Dave Fridman in, because we're all Flaming Lips fans. And so we kind of wanted to go down that sort of avenue. And he was much more open to experimenting, and we had more time. Whereas with Kevin, we only had 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
We banged out, like every first album should be, just bang it out, get it done. Second album, actually start thinking about it more. And Dave was great. Like whatever was in my head, he would sort of happily wait till it came out, or would pull it out and say, what do you think? What sort of sounds do you want? But we were in New York State when we were doing that. So it was a really weird. You're out in the sticks in this studio. We were living upstairs, and we just come down in the morning and record. And there's actually, I got a good story about that actually, because it was the second last day of recording, and John O'Donnell, using his A&R tricks, quite a famous, not famous, just famous amongst us, he sent a fax back at the time saying, I can't hear a single. And this is like at 7 o'clock, we've got like a day's worth of recording left. And he sends this through, and I thought, you bastard. But I thought, I got all these good pop songs. I thought, you know, we're good, the album's good. And I didn't realise at the time, I think I actually had a massive anxiety attack. It was really kind of not good. And it was just, you're in the middle of nowhere and there's like this dirt track in New York State. And I was just walking for like kilometres up and down this thing. And then we just went to bed upstairs. I had one more day of recording, and I woke up in the morning and literally that song just fell out. I woke up at like about 6 a.m. Upstairs, the other guys were still asleep, and I had the song. It was like...
You're not the only one.
Yeah.
Wow.
And it was like literally all the lyrics I didn't even think about the lyrics. They just
fell.
Happened. And the music literally happened, and... I remember Alan getting up and I said, dude, I've got a song. It's going in the studio's obviously right there. And so we worked on it. And then Dave Fridman came in at about 9, said, beautiful, let's record it. We recorded it. I did my vocal. Simon put his bass down. That was it.
Done.
And then here you go, John. Here's your single. and I wrote back,
Is your bloody single or something a little bit heavier than that.
I look back now and go, of course he did it. I mean, that's, you know, I probably would have, if I was the A&R guy, I probably would have done the same thing as hell. So I love you, John. Forced me into a good song. Yeah.
Reminds me of that, not Motley Crue, Def Leppard story. They're the same thing. They're recording Hysteria. Record company says, can't hear a song. And they'd pretty much finished the record. And lo and behold, they write, Pour Some Sugar on Me. Yeah, right at the last minute. I mean, classic stuff.
It is. Classic A&R technique. And it works.
I want to go back to you supporting Foo Fighters. Because they were they're still massive to this day, a global band. But for three guys out of Perth to snare the Foo Fighters support in Australia, what do you remember about that?
I remember Alan breaking a snare drum, or the snare on his snare drum, so the metal trap underneath. Taylor was right there, and he knew exactly, and he goes, and literally came out in between songs and gave Alan a new snare to play with. He was that passionate about it. I remember, did we jam with him? I think we jammed with him. Really, like, he was just a sound check, just going, you guys want to play? You guys want to play? Didn't see much of Dave Grohl at all, actually. I remember seeing Taylor a lot. Because you remember we're down in Tassie and he's going, you know, the hotel, shit. Yeah. What do you mean? It's Tassie. It's beautiful. We were in this beautiful old hotel and he goes, like, TV shit, food shit. I was going, really? Because he was just a touring musician. That's where he lived, in a hotel.
Would have seen a lot of hotels.
But I remember the crowds being enormous, and we were of a pretty similar ilk back then. That was a really early time for them as well, and they were still sort of gelling as a band, whereas we'd been around for a while, so I'll say they were looser, but, you know, even back then I thought we gave them a run for their money. Oh. And that's probably, I'm probably pumping myself up too much, but I thought we were doing all right. We were doing all right against them, yeah.
It's a good way to be.
Yeah, and they've done pretty well for themselves. So, you know.
Not a bad band, that one.
Yeah.
I want to go back to Sleepwalking because since you agreed to be part of Sound As Ever Presents and Leaps and Bounds, that's just been my go-to song. Yep. Let's have a quick listen and we'll chat about it.
Okay.
Good, Dave. So good. Still stands up. And now I can hear the swerve driver influences plain as day. Maybe I did back then, but it didn't register so much. But I can hear them.
We were obsessed with them. I still am a bit. But even back in the day, we're all obsessed. That was our sort of go-to band. We all love Swerve Driver, you know. That was that sort of. They're an English band that sounded American, and they had all that sort of.
It was a real feedback guitar, wasn't it?
Yeah. But the first time they played in Australia, they were in Perth, and it was a ridiculously hot day in Perth, like 40 degrees. It was stupid. And they were playing at a club in Perth, and we were supporting. And so they've just got off the plane. It's stinking hot. They've got this full venue, and the band that's supporting them sounds like them. And I remember them walking on just like, what going on? And they even said, I remember they said something about, it must have been about Sleepwalking, but something about us sounding like them or something like that. I was sort of going, yeah, we do. I can think of worse bands to sound like. And I still love them to this day. They're just they're so unique. And I still see them every time they come, I always go along.
Dylan and I caught up with them when we were doing a show about 2 or 3 years ago, just a little caravan show, and we actually got them in. And it was just so good to see them again. And they had Mickey from Supergrass on, I think he's playing bass with them. So that was a double, and yeah, they played the Croxton. So wonderful. So yeah, fantastic.
They are a great band. They're just, you know, I think they're sort of musicians, all the musos like them, and because their chords are so interesting, the tunings are so interesting, they're so unique, and I love them to bits.
So Dave, you'll be hitting the Fitzroy Town Hall, which, let's be honest, ain't probably the best for rock and roll, so you'll have to probably turn it down just a tad.
Righto. We'll see how many people we get. Might deaden the room a little bit.
Oh, I have great faith, Dave, in our Sound as Ever members. I know they'll embrace you with open arms, so fear not. What are you going to open with?
King Carter.
Oh, God. This takes me back to being an announcer on Triple J. I remember super request, Ken Carter. Is that Ken Carter, Ammonia?
No, it's a trip playing those songs again. Like, it is, because I literally have not played those songs in 20 years. So when we started rehearsing, like, all these old tunes, like, in a box and stuff like that, I'm going, oh my God, you know, and it's all the muscle memory is completely still there. It's like,
wow,
and it never changed. It was like, oh my God, that's right. I might, a couple of the solos I had to brush up on, but other than that, it was just like, it was all still there.
It's all there. How about the lyrics though? You still remember the lyrics as clear as day?
Yeah, still got to go back over them a little bit. Yeah, well, I should be right before gig time. I had to write a few of them out, so that's all right, but I remember them.
Yeah, my band actually reformed back in 2018 for a Mavis's Caligula show at the Prince of Wales.
Oh,
and
wow. Yep.
It was so much fun getting up there again with for me it was the same people, and but also just revisiting those songs that I had written when I was such, you know, so much younger.
Yeah.
And some of them felt like old boyfriends that you kind of, you know, you loved for a while and then you're happy to see again and you put them away, but the, you know, some of the other songs, they, yeah, like you say, never left me, like the muscle memory for those. So
I
dare say you'll have a lot of fun.
I'm really looking forward to playing again, actually, sort of, and not just this gig, actually playing again.
Yeah.
And sort of get, my kids are old enough now that, you know, if I'm away for a little bit, it's not going to be that sort of detrimental to their psychological thing. And it feels like a good time to be doing it. You know, I think COVID, like 2020 probably played a factor in it as well. And I thought, if I'm not going to do it now, I'm never going to do it. So. Loving playing the songs again. I love sort of being loud and playing guitar again. And the guys I'm playing with are great. So it's a good little tight little three piece. So nice and neat.
You mentioned your wife earlier being a fan of the Foes. Was she a fan of Ammonia?
No.
That blunt, huh?
Yeah. I think she gets embarrassed when I start singing. I did this for this is my job.
This was 8 years of my life, God damn you.
Really? She goes, yeah. No. But no, I think she saw us at a big day out, but was just feeling nonplussed.
Right. We'll have to change that, Dave. It might take you 20 years, but maybe, you know, now's the time.
She's all right. She still loves the Foes. That's all right.
Dave Johnson, it's been awesome catching up with you. Really looking forward to the show and seeing you potentially out and about on the gig circuit, you know, if and when lockdown COVID/everything else permits. But it's been really fab just catching up with you, connecting again.
Yeah, it's really nice to catch up with you too, Jane. I'm looking forward to catching up with everybody. It's been way too long. And I'm just looking forward to getting back into it and playing and seeing everybody again. It's going to be really nice.
He's out of the indie pop wilderness, everybody.
Looking forward to it, buddy.
See ya.
See you, mate.